Joining us now as our second guest for Hot Copy, as we continue our conversation on the latest Pulse Asia survey, we have political analyst Professor Edmund Thayo on Hot Copy. Good morning, Professor Ed.
Good morning. Good morning to everyone.
Okay, Professor Ed, from the election surveys, we get a glimpse of who. Now, from you, perhaps we can understand why them. Now, let's take a look at the top contenders in each of the key races, the presidential, vice presidential, and the Senate race. That's Bongbong Marcos, Sara Duterte, and Rafi Tulfo. Now, what are they doing right, collectively speaking, and what are they doing well, individually speaking? We can break it down per person. Go ahead.
Well, you know, in the senatorial race, it's quite difficult to distinguish really what one is doing distinctly compared to the other. No, it's a multi-member district, so to speak, if we use the electoral language jargon. No, so meaning you're not only voting for one single person, you're voting for 12 senators. So if you're popular and you really are already known to many, and of course you campaign and you let the people know that you're running for office, then you already have at the outset, no, the edge over the others. Now, as far as those who've been senators before, of course, it's an entirely different rule, so to speak. We are, in fact, going to look at all the senatorial elections before. Those who always, well, performed well, to say the least, no, and that the people have been made aware of their track record, then ultimately they always make it back in the Senate. But there are also instances that comebacking senators don't make it. We've seen this in former senators Maseda, Ople, T.J. Gingon, and so many others. Either their work in the Senate, no, have not been communicated well, not their track record have not been communicated well, or that the people simply have preferred, no, new names, so to speak. And almost always in a senatorial election, there's always a new name, there's always a new face that's being elected.
Okay, let's look at the presidential race, specifically based on Pulse Asia's last and most recent survey. There was almost no movement in the presidential survey, with former Senator Bongbong Marcos Jr. still leading with 56% of the votes, despite VP Robredo's massive rallies from March to April, and even though huge groups shifted to her side. What do you think this is? What do you think the Liberal Party is doing right, and what are they doing wrong?
Mikey, I wrote quite well. It's actually a short piece. It's a 4 to 5 minute read in your ABS-CBN website. Perhaps the viewers can look it up. But in a nutshell, this has been the trend all along. No, since the filing of the certificate of candidacy, I don't remember any instance, no, that any other candidate, not VP Lenny, not Mayor Risco, or not Manny Pacquiao, led in the surveys. Second of all, it's quite unprecedented. It's difficult to just compare the current surveys with all the previous surveys, considering, I mean, all the previous elections, not surveys in the previous elections, considering that it's the first time that the front runner would net more than 50% of all the respondents. No, so to speak, that you know, all the tail enders, even if you put their numbers all together, will not be enough to unseat or overturn, not the lead of the front runner. Third, the usual argument that there's always an increase in the attendees of campaign rallies. This has also been reported in the media, not only in ABS-CBN, but many other media, print, broadcast, media, and even in the social media, that many of those attending the rallies are also the ones attending previous rallies. And so it's really difficult to determine whether the massive attendance, no, represent the support of a particular candidate in the particular area where the rally is being held. No, so in all the elections that we've had, I don't remember any other reference that we use to determine who may have an edge or who is who has an advantage in a particular area or region other than the surveys. No, it's quite interesting, really, that every election, those who don't make it in the survey numbers always question the methodology, always question the validity of the survey. So ultimately, let's see if the result of the coming elections, anyway, it's just a few days now, will reflect numbers in the surveys. But again, if we go back in all the previous elections, the result of the elections always have been consistent with the numbers in the surveys.
Okay. Professor Ed, people have said that it's, you know, talking about Bongbong Marcos's consistent and massive lead, people have said that it's dangerous to come out with such as to be a front runner, to be at the top early on, because, you know, all the other ones will know to target you and bring you down. Everyone said that this is dangerous to be the first one and to do it consistently because you're going to be a target. But no one has been able to bring him down. Why do you think this is? They haven't been able to work together to affect his numbers.
This is not the first time, Mikey, that this is going to happen. No, I've always explained in many discussions before that, the first time that it happened is in 1998. From the get-go, former vice president, former mayor, and eventually became the president in 1998, the former president Erap Estrada, led the surveys from the get-go, no, and maintained that lead. And there was so much brickbats, so to speak. Practically everything was thrown at him at that time. But, he stayed at the top and made it in the 1998 presidential elections. The same thing happened when the late President Noynoy Aquino finally declared his certificate, his intent to run, September 9, 2015. I remember it rather clearly because it's the first time now that the surveys reflected 60% for Noynoy Aquino September of 2015. Except that the numbers of candidate Noynoy Aquino plateaued at about 30-35% in the run-up to the 2016 elections. But he maintained that lead just the same and also won the 2016 election. So it's not the first time. The only unprecedented detail as far as this election is concerned is, again, if I may underscore, is the fact that the front runner will be more than 50% of respondents asked in the surveys.
Okay, that said, do you think the Vice President Lenny Robredo still has a chance here?
Well, if our reference and the only reference we have are the surveys, it seems that the Vice President really will have to settle for the second place.
Yeah, I mean, if you add up all the votes of the respondents, from Robredo, Pacquiao, Moreno, Lacson, they still won't even add up to the lead of the front runner.
In fact, the movement in their numbers are movements only between the other contenders. The numbers of the front runner has not been really moving. Now, I was asked yesterday why the number of VP Robredo went down to 1%. I said, any movement in the numbers that is less than the margin of error will not be a significant movement. So, which means that the numbers of the tail enders remain the same. So, sila lang yung nagpapalitan compared to the front runner that has maintained his numbers.
Okay, rare and a remote as it may be, what's a possible black swan event that could change the outcome based on the surveys?
Well, last week I was also asked by ABS-CBN the same question. And the answer there is, a black swan. Something that's unexpected. I can just hope and pray that if there will be a black swan, that it will not be as disturbing, as probably even less than the pandemic. If it will be disturbing, that will not be good for the economy. That will not be good for political development in this country. Hopefully, let's just wait and see how the people actually will vote. All this huff and puff will, finally end when the election day comes.
Okay, based on the figures, Marcus's strength comes from the 18 to 24 year old age bracket, with 72% of the respondents in that group favoring him. On the other hand, Roberta's strength comes from the older set, those ages 65 years and old and up. That's Marcos's weakest area, by the way. Now, what does this tell you, and what can future and aspiring politicians or those seeking higher office learn from this?
Actually, Mikey, it's difficult to, again, disaggregate the numbers, because even if we say that a particular sector netted more than 70% for the particular candidate, like the front runner, for example, the fact remains that across all sectors, socioeconomic classes and ages, it seems that the front runner is the same. And this is the reason why you have more than 50%, not as far as the former Senator Bongbong Marcos is concerned. If there's anything to learn from this, is for the contenders like VP Lenny, for example, she might want to capitalize or build on the particular sector where she is, where she netted the most numbers. No, but I bet, of course, that these numbers again have not been enough really to improve his overall numbers.
Okay. Now, while President Duterte has endorsed his daughter, he hasn't endorsed anyone for president. Sticking to his guns, he promised this earlier on, and up to now, he still hasn't. If he were to somehow, at the nth hour, 1 week before the elections, if he were to endorse a presidential candidate, do you think that it would move the needle either way?
I don't think it will still be significant, Mikey. No backing out from any presidential contender and endorsing another, or the endorsement of the president, would be enough, for the simple reason that there's not enough time anymore to go around and inform practically everyone that, hey, I'm not running for office. I'm instead endorsing this particular candidate. In the case of the president, the same thing. He goes around and says that I will entrust the office that I'm vacating to this particular person. There's simply no time anymore. Everyone has already gone around the whole country, pressed flesh, and responded to all kinds of queries from attendees to of rallies and so on and so forth. Even in the age of social media, whether we like it or not, there are still areas in the country that remain dependent on or relying on radio for not only information but even for entertainment. And so it will be quite difficult to inform everyone that this is the endorsement and I'm supporting a particular candidate.
Okay. On a more macro level, election surveys play a crucial and complex role. Though the sample size may be small relative to the number of actual voters, just how impactful are these pre-election surveys?
You know, we have to ask a statistician or an expert in this regard. But what I know as a researcher is that there's a particular threshold, so to speak. If you noticed, even if you increase the number of respondents, the margin of error would likely remain, or that the decrease in the margin of error would be, not really that much. So if you notice, the margin of errors would be maximum of 3% or 1 to 1.5%. So the difference is rather really small. No, precisely because it depends on the sampling, it depends on the way that you are going to use a particular method in doing the survey. But then again, Mikey, there have been so many questions almost always. Now, in every election, surveys are questioned, whether it's valid, whether it's conducted right, whether the questions have not been formulated in favor of a particular candidate, and so on and so forth. Again, I don't remember any survey that has not been able to determine who the front runner is at the very least. The numbers may vary in terms of percentage and the actual votes. It may vary. It has always varied. But in terms of who is the front runner, it has always been the same as far as the actual elections is concerned. It's the first time, if ever, that this is not going to happen this coming elections if the result would be different.
Okay, now for the first time ever, we're conducting elections under the shadow of a global pandemic. How would you say COVID-19 has changed the breadth, the scale, and the campaign strategies of these candidates this year?
It's good that you asked that, Mikey. It's a quite interesting detail, no? But, you know, to be honest, I don't think it has, resulted into any major difference. In fact, there's always this, I don't know where that argument came from, that the front runner is the front runner because his campaign is really far better than the other campaigns and so on and so forth, and that he has all the resources and so on and so forth, and that his style is adapted to the the pandemic situation and so on and so forth. I don't really think that is the point. It's a question of resources, no doubt, but I'm inclined to think that if you compare the campaigns of all the different candidates, the resources are comparable, and that the campaign managers, in fact, are also very, qualified. No, campaign managers in practically all the presidential contenders. And so what I'm inclined to explain really is that the overall scenario really explains why the result is what it is. Meaning that our politics has remained the same, no? Even before, no? It's always the same names, it's always the same players, it's always the same families battling for election posts, whether you're talking of local or national election. Until such time that we change the kind of I don't call it a political system anymore, I just call it the kind of politics. Until such time that we change it and we put in place a kind of system that really fits our conditions, our circumstances, then this is the kind of elections that we'll always have. And we'll always say that, nadaya ako, it should have been this candidate who has won, and so on and so forth.
Okay, it's interesting that you mentioned that, because most of the probable winners in the races are either incumbent or former members of government. Until then, until we can change, you know, the things that you said mentioned earlier, how on earth can other aspiring politicians break through?
Well, first off, Mikey, they have to have the money. Actually, this is just a simple explanation to it. In fact, the only explanation why we also have the local positions with other contenders, not just one single politician running for office, is for the simple reason that if you want to run for office, you have to be willing to spend your own money. And it's like betting, so to speak, no? In a race or something. Now, if you have already, come to a conclusion that you don't stand a chance, why will you still be using your own money, no, to bet on something? And so that has always been the, vicious circle, so to speak. Until such time, again, if I may repeat, until such time that we have real political parties, that candidates can run for office without them spending so much of their own. This is the same kind of politics over and over again. We will be choosing. We will be choosing from the same names, the same groups over and over again.
Okay, that's all the time we have. We'll have to leave it at that. Thank you for your time this morning, Professor Ed.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.